الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We've spoken about مكانة السنه, the position that the sunnah holds, and we spoke about عنايه السلف بها, the importance that the salaf gave the sunnah, right? And we spoke about the sahabas and the tabi'een, the way that they venerated and honored the sunnah. Now we're going to go into the last chapter for today, which is how the people of whims and desires are towards the sunnah. أصحاب الأهواء والفرق. أصحاب الأهواء والفرق. The people of desires and the people of innovation. وموقفهم من حجية السنة. Now we've spoken about the position that the sunnah holds, how the salaf gave importance to the sunnah. Let's talk about the opposite groups, the deviated groups. What does the sunnah mean to them? Okay? And how do they see the sunnah? At this time, وَمَوْقِفُهُمْ مِنْ حُجِّيَّةِ السُنَّةِ. We're now going to mention some of the prominent people who came. Remember I mentioned the statement of Muhammad ibn Sirin. كانوا, the Salaf, they never used to ask. كانوا لا يسألون عن الإسناد. فَلَمَّا وَقَعَتِ الْفِتْنَةِ. They never used to ask about the chain. But when the fitna happened, what fitna is he talking about? He's talking about when the innovators came. Verification is needed. Some of the innovators who came is Abdullah ibn Sab' al-Yahudi. Abdullah ibn Sab' al-Yahudi. For example, who came is Ja'ad ibn Dirham. إبراهيم النظام بشر المريسي جهم بن صفوان جهم بن صفوان. These are the people who came. Each and every one of them, Abdullah ibn Sab' al-Yahudi was asl Yahudi. He came into Islam to destroy it. Ja'ad ibn Dirham, his chain, Ja'ad ibn Dirham's chain goes into what? It goes into the man who done magic on the Prophet ﷺ. Labid ibn al-Asam, it goes into him. Ja'ad, since he sent it, it's from there. All of these people, they came to destroy Islam within. Ibrahim al-Nadham al-Mu'tazili, Bishr al-Marisi, where Ahmed ibn Hanbal and Uthman al-Darimi and other scholars, Imam al-Shafi'i and others, they refuted him. Jahm ibn Safwan, which the group, the Jahmiyyah, attribute themselves to. These are the people who came. Fitna started happening now. And what was their debate and their arguments? Issues pertaining to the Sunnah. Sunnah was respected and it was venerated, the Salaf loved it. As I gave examples, the Quran gave him, like, these individuals started coming and they started saying things. Are you with me, brothers? Now I'm going to mention something very important, which is how was their rejection of the hadith? How were they doing it? They did it in two ways. I want you to take this point on, it's very important. Number one is رد السنة بمجرد عقولهم. The way that they rejected was what? Rejecting the Sunnah based on their intellects. Like Ibrahim and Nadham and others, we'll go into more details, don't worry. Rejecting the Sunnah based on their logic. This doesn't make sense to me. This hadith does not make sense to me. My mind cannot digest it. What? So it's rejected. We'll speak about that in more details, inshaAllah ta'ala. Second one was what? الطعنُ في رواتها. بالهوى. Please pay attention to this point, because this is, really is important for all of us to know. The second one is, first one is رد السنة بعقول. First one was what? They reject a hadith based on their what? On their logic. The second one is الطعن في رواتها. They start to criticize the narrators, like pretending to be like the people of hadith, but their rejection of the narrators is based upon what? Bilhawa. Based on desires. They're not following the science of hadith. They're not following the science of hadith. They're rejecting the sunnah. First of all, it doesn't make sense to us. This hadith is not logical. This hadith does not make sense logically. Number two, at-ta'nu fi ruwatiha bilhawa. Criticizing the narrators based on desires. Saying this narrator, I'm not going to take his hadith. Based on desires. We'll take examples of that. Okay. Let's add a third one to it. وضع الحديث. Fabricating narrations. And the reason why they will fabricate narrations is they will make up narrations that logically don't make sense. And they will say, look at the sunnah. It's mentioning things that don't logically make sense. Are you with me, brothers? They will make up narrations. They will fabricate narrations. And say the Prophet said this. And once people start thinking the Prophet said it, they said, does this even logically make sense what your Prophet is saying? In order to reject the sunnah, they fabricate narrations. And when they fabricate the narration, knowingly that this narration logically doesn't make sense, then they say, let's reject all the sunnah because it doesn't logically make sense. Are you with me? Sorry, wad'u al-hadith. Wad'u al-hadith. It's wad'u al-hadith is to place the hadith. Okay. Let's look at the first one, which is raddu sunnati bi'uqulihim. Rejecting the sunnah based on their in their intellect. They do that in two ways. When you see them reject the hadith based on their intellect, they do it in two ways. The first one is a rad mutlaq. This one is called what? Rad مطلق, unrestrictedly. They're the ones who are called Al-Qur'aniyun. They call themselves Zuran wa Buhtanan wa Tadleelan. They call themselves Al-Qur'aniyun. That we follow the Qur'an. They say the Sunnah doesn't logically make sense. So what should we do? Reject it in all totality. The hadith, the Qur'an is enough for us. Are you with me? The Qur'an is what? The Qur'an is enough for us. The second one is what? Rad juz'i. Rad juz'i. They don't unrestrictedly, let's call it rad muqayyad. Because this is mutlaq, let's say rad muqayyad instead of calling it juz'i. These ones are called rad muqayyad. Rad muqayyad. which means it's a restricted type of rejection. It's not unrestricted. It's restricted. What is it restricted to? I will accept it if it's multitude narration. But if it's few in number, if it's ahad, don't bring it to me. Are you with me, brothers? So the first ones are unrestrictedly forget the sunnah. Leave sunnah. Why are you going to the sunnah? Isn't the Quran not enough? That's the first rejection. So when you ask them why, the sunnah doesn't logically make sense. The sunnah is what's bringing us the problem in the first place. Are you with me? So let's get rid of the sunnah. We're going to go into details. Each one we're going to go in details. But I first want you to understand the outline. The second one are, we reject the sunnah. But not unrestrictedly. Hey, how? We reject the sunnah if it's single narration. So they're restricted. They're only restricted to this ahad. If it's few in number, we don't take. We want multitude narration. So please pay attention with me here. Please pay attention with me here, because we're going to take these two, inshallah ta'ala, for the next remaining time that we have. We're going to take these two, okay? The next 15 minutes, we're going to take both of those. Rad mutlaq and the rad muqayyad. Okay? Let's look at those who come with the rad mutlaq. The rad mutlaq, as I mentioned to you, are those who believe the Quran is enough and we don't need no sunnah, and that the Quran is the only thing in Islam that should be taken, and there's no evidence to follow the sunnah. Those ones, we've already spoken about them somehow. Remember at the beginning the story that I mentioned of Hassan al-Basri and Imran ibn Hussein, the man who said to Imran ibn Hussein when he was sitting with him, he said, لا تحدثنا إلا بالقرآن. He said to Imran ibn Hussein, don't tell us anything other than the Quran, right? And then Imran ibn Hussein, he said to him, Udru, come close. And then he came close and he said to him, do you not see if the Quran and its affairs were placed in your hands, how would you determine the way to pray the Salah? How would you know Dhuhr is 4 and Asr is 4 and Maghrib is 3 and Isha is 4 and Fajr is 2? How would you know the Tawaf around the Kaaba is 7? How would you know the Sa'i between Safa and Marwa is 7? Where would you get that from, he said. So that is Rad Mutlaq. And Imran ibn Hussein refuted him in that. Here the question I researched is, was this at the time of the Salaf a one-off incident? There were individuals like that, one-off. Or were there a group who believed only the Quran? If you look at Al-Imam al-Shafi'i's two books, Jumma'u al-Ilm and his other kitab al-Risala, you kind of sense there was a group like that. But the only group that when I researched and I looked into the books of firaq and sects, the only group that I can say that meet that criteria, that were most likely like that, were the Shia. Because the Shia, they done takfir of the Sahabas, right? So they would reject the Sunnah. They were what? They would reject the Sunnah. So most likely, they would be the first group to be said that they came with what? Rad. Rad mutlaq. Rejecting the Sunnah in totality and not accepting it. And an Imam al-Shafi'i, in his kitab al-Risala, Jumma'u al-Ilm, and his kitab al-Umm, he refutes them. He has chapters on them in refuting them when it comes to the issue of following the Sunnah. Also, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he has a kitab in Hajj al-Sunnah Nabawiyyah, where he proves that the Shia, they don't take the Sunnah and they reject it in totality. And there's another kitab called Miftah al-Jannah wal-Ihtijaj bis-Sunnah by Suyuti rahimahullah ta'ala, and the kitab by Abu Wazir al-Yamani, Ar-Rawd al-Basim fi al-Dhabbi an Sunnati Abi al-Qasim. These are three books that one should try to, inshallah ta'ala, look into. But I want to come to this group today who reject the Sunnah in totality today. Where do we see them? Where are they? When the British colony came to India and the non-Muslims, they have their different ways of attacking a nation. It's not just always military. Sometimes it's psychological and it's other ways they do it. And in one of the ways that they did it was to destroy Islam within. And so they made groups. So because the British were a military force in India and the people of India were trying to liberate them from the country, they created a group known as the Ahmadiyya. And the idea behind it was for them not to fight with the British soldiers. So Mirza Ghulam Ahmed and others and groups like that were made, who then rejected the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the group of the Qur'aniyun had started to have a weight in India, and they have a books and authors and works, and that's in terms of India. In the Arab world, two groups took it. The first group was a madrasa called Al-Madrasatul Al-Islahiyya. It's called Madrasatul Al-Islahiyya. And it was a madrasa that was based in what? Egypt. It was based in Egypt. And the way that Madrasatul Salihiyya tried to spread their rejection of the sunnah in totality was in two ways. Number one, they had a magazine called Majallatul Manar. And Majallatul Manar was actually a magazine or a newspaper that was looked over by one great sheikh who, before I go to him, before him was Muhammad Abdu, and Muhammad Abdu took from his sheikh Jamaluddin Al-Afghani. Jamaluddin Al-Afghani rejected sunnah in totality, and so did his student Muhammad Abdu, and then Muhammad Rashid Rida, who carried on the magazine in Egypt, Majallatul Manar. He also used to let in the Majallatul Manar some articles on rejection of the sunnah in totality and not accepting of the sunnah. For example, one of the magazines that were out was Al-Islamu Huwa Al-Qur'an Wahda. Islam is only the Qur'an. And it was something he looked over and he approved of. The second way that they did it, this Madrasa al-Islahiyya, was a book written called Adwa'u ala Sunnati al-Muhammadiyya by Abu Rayya. Okay? Abu Rayya. And one sheikh from Yemen, Sheikh al-Allama Abdul Rahman Yahya al-Mu'allimi, he wrote a kitab called Al-Anwar al-Kashifa, which he refuted Abu Rayya in the issue of the Sunnah and his rejection of the Sunnah. And another sheikh, al-Suba'i, he wrote a good kitab called Al-Sunnah wa Makanatuha, the Sunnah and its position. That's the first group. Now I'm going to go into the next group. Okay? I'm going to go into the next group, which is those who rejected the sunnah restricted like him. What did they do? Restricted. What did they restrict it to? This is Rad Muqayyad. They said if it's only few in narration. If it's few in narration, what do? We reject it. But if it's multitude in narration, we accept it, they said. We will what? We will accept it. Between themselves, they differed. So they said few in narration. The Mu'tazila, which is the first group, they said, we will not take ahad, which is few, we won't take it in ahkam, and we will not also take it in al-i'tiqad. So they rejected the few in fiqh-related issues, and they also rejected in what? An aqidah. That's the Mu'tazila. So this group, this is three types. The first type is the Mu'tazila, who said, we take mutawatir in fiqh, and we take mutawatir in what? Aqidah. The second group is the Asha'ira. Al-Asha'ira. Asha'ira, they said, we take ahad in ahkam. There's no problem. Fiqh, no problem. Like we don't take ahad in what? Al-i'tiqad. We won't take ahad in aqidah. Are you with me? Does that make sense? And the third group of scholars is Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. What did they say? Ahlul Sunnah is the third group of people. What did they say? They said, we will take it. We will take ahad in i'tiqad and we will take it in ahkam. Okay? We will take it in i'tiqad and we'll take it in ahkam. There's no exception. The Prophet ﷺ said it, if it meets the criteria of what? وَأَهْلُ هَذَا الشَّأْنِ قَسَّمُ السُّنَنِ إِلَى صَحِيحٍ وَضَعِيفٍ وَحَسَنٍ. The first one is what? أَوَّلُهَا مَا اتَّصَلَ سَنَدُهُ. It's whatever its chain of narration is what? It's connected. The sanad is connected. بِنَقْلِ عَدْلٍ ضَابِضِ فُؤَادِ مِنْ غَيْرِ مَا شُذُوذٍ وَعِلَّةٍ قَادِحَةٍ فُتُودِي. It meets the criteria of authenticity, we take it. If it doesn't meet the criteria of authenticity, we reject it. We don't look at whether it's ahad or not, doesn't matter. Five conditions we look at. If those five conditions are met, sahih. Whether it's few in narration or whether it's large in narration, it doesn't matter. That's what Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah said. As for these two other groups, they deviated and diverted from the what? From the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Does that make sense? So we've learnt how the innovators are regarding the proof of the sunnah. Hujjiyatu sunnah inda ahli al-ahwa'i wal-firaq, the people of desires and the people of deviation, this is it. First of all, these are the people who caused the division in Islam. It came from them originally, and the way they rejected it is in three ways. Raddu sunnati bi'uqulihim, at-ta'anu fi ruwatiha bil-hawa. Any narrator they don't like, criticize him. Like Imam al-Bukhari, sahih today. You hear people say, Bukhari, he was not even Arab. وَمَا إِلَىٰ ذَٰلِكَ. Sahih. Criticizing him. Are you with me, brothers? And the third one is وَضْعُ الْحَدِيثِ. Some of them were making up hadith. They were lying about the Prophet ﷺ deliberately. And the reason why they were lying about the Prophet was what? To break Islam within. It was to destroy Islam within. And as a country has border controls that control the border, the people who control the borders of the Sharia are the ulama, scholars of hadith. They protect it from whatever's coming. Who are you? Where's your visa? Okay, you can come in. The people who do that are who? Ahlul hadith. They're hurras al-Sharia. They're the border control. They protect it from who's coming, who's leaving. Are you with me, brothers? And without them, wallahi, our religion would be like the religion of the Jews and the Christians. The Jews and the Christians, what's happened to them now? If you go to the church on Saturday, they're singing, they're dancing. In the UK, that's how they are. On Saturday, in the church, there's no worshipping, they're dancing. What happened? Their scholars didn't protect the borders. So everybody came, they added what they wanted to do it. So if you go to three churches next to each other, each church is doing whatever they want. Each church is doing whatever they want. And this shows that if the religion is not protected and it's not looked after, it will head towards that direction. It will head where? It will head towards that direction. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruhu wa atubu ilayh. Any questions? So when we go to the shurut al-sahih, inshallah, in the tadween al-hadith, we're going to go in more details. We're going to go in great details. The first one is Abdullah ibn Sabah al-Yahudi. The second one, Abdullah ibn Sabah al-Yahudi. The second one is Ja'ad ibn Dirham. Ja'ad ibn Dirham. The third one is Ibrahim al-Nazzam al-Mu'tazili. Number four is Bishr al-Marisi. Al-Marisi. Bishr al-Marisi. And number five is Jaham ibn Safwan. Jaham ibn Safwan. I just wanted to, inshallah ta'ala, inform you all, if you didn't hear about it, that there's going to be a one-day seminar starting after Salatul Asri today, and it's going to carry on until 10-11 o'clock, inshallah ta'ala. It's on the topic of hope in the times of hardship. how to have hope in the time of what? Hardship. Inshallah ta'ala, the first speaker will be Sheikh Muhammad Tim Humble, and he will be speaking about the topic of dua of Nabiullah Yunus ibn Matta. The dua that he made. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith al-sahih that anyone who makes this dua, Allah will remove from him any gham and ham, depression and sadness. But you always have to remember something, brothers. When Allah and His Messenger say, if you do this, this will happen, there's an explanation and a understanding behind it. I'll just give you one quick benefit. Allah says in the Surah Al-Fatiha, we read Fatiha, right? What did Allah say? Ihdina? Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. You all know the hadith of Abu Hurairah in Sahih al-Bukhari, right? That Allah says, Hamadani abdi, majadani abdi, hada bayni wa bayna abdi, sah? When the person says, Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, do you know what Allah says? Hada bayni wa bayna abdi, wa li'abdi mas'al. This is between me and my slave will receive what he asked for. Ponder here now. Allah is the person saying, Ihdina al-sirat al-mustaqim. Allah is saying, Hada bayni wa bayna abdi. This is between me and my slave. Wali abdi, and my slave will be given what he asked for. So it means that the person will be guided. True or false? Because that's what the person is asking for. Allah guide me. And Allah is saying, I'll give them what they asked for. But aren't there some people who say, Ihdina al-sirat al-mustaqim, and they're not guided? True or false? Why? What are the previous ayats? So you need to, the reason I'm not going to answer this question for you guys is because when the Quran says something like that, or the sunnah says, if you make this dua, this will happen for you, there's an explanation to it. Are you with me, brothers? Because somebody will make the dua of Nabilah Yunus ibn Matta and the depression doesn't go. And the sadness doesn't go. True or false? Why? Why does it not go? So come to the seminar, inshallah ta'ala. Find out. Find out why when you make this dua, it doesn't go. Inshallah, yeah. Manuscripts. There are many books that are there. Yeah, there was, like, for example, you all know the story of, you all know the ideology and the concept that's been pushed that the Quran is not, it hasn't, the Quran itself has been changed and the manuscripts. Have you heard this doubt before? You know where this doubt came from? This doubt came from a Orientalist who did tahqiq of the Kitab al-Masahif, Ibn Abi Dawud. This Kitab al-Masahif is one of the books that talk about the manuscript, the mushafs that Uthman sent. This book is written by the son of Abu Dawud. Abu Dawud the Sunan. His son wrote it, Abu Bakr. An Orientalist brought this manuscript out. First person who brought it out was the Orientalist. He was a German Orientalist. He brought it out. His name was Arthur something. He brought it out. At the beginning, he brought all the shubhas. Because the Muslims didn't yet produce the book, what happened? Anybody who wants to read the book has to buy the one that he worked on. Are you with me, brothers? And so the doubt creeped into the Muslim countries like that. Are you with me, brothers? I went to British Library. Whilst I was studying my university, I used to have a university card, ID, so I was permitted to go to the British Library, and I got to know the workers there, and they would let me take manuscripts and whatnot. One day I was on the tilt, and I was waiting for a copy of one of the books. So the book I was looking for was one of the books written by Sirajuddin al-Bulqini. So I went, wallahi, this is a true story. Sirajuddin al-Bulqini's kitab I wanted, I asked, can you copy this for me? As I was asking for the book, a white British English came over, stood right next to me. And he said, I've seen you come here and... But he said, why do you say Sirajuddin al-Bulqini? He said it to me. I said, that's how the scholars say it, and that's how it's said in the books, and that's how I read it. He said, the correct name is Sirajuddin al-Bulqini. Wallahi, he was right. I researched and I found out it was correct. He's right. And I tajabbed. And I called some of the mashayikhs and I told them, and they said, really, they researched, they came back to me, they said, yeah, it's right. Are you with me, brothers? So, akhi, the Torah, the works that are present in the Muslim, in the West, in the British Library, and are you with me? Just yesterday, somebody sent me something. What was it? The Muqtasar of Al-Ba'li. Ba'li's Muqtasar of a Kitab. And it was taken from the British Library in London. Wallahi al-Azim. A copy. I have it on my iPad. It's a copy they were sent for me from the British Library. I emailed the British Library when I was told it was there. They emailed it to me. No other copy. No other way. This is the only copy they have. Are you with me, brothers? So what's the chance of somebody tampering with your sources and playing with it and causing more division amongst the Muslims and changing words here and there? Are you with me? So it's sad. If you go to the libraries today in the Western countries, like for example the UK and others, the majority of the people who are in the library are not Muslims. The non-Muslims are more in the library. They're the ones who are reading. They're the ones who are studying. They're the ones who are researching. The Muslims don't read. Yeah? It's little they read. So we need to wake up and learn and study our own Torah, our own heritage, and look into it. Last question, inshallah. Huh? Yeah, there's a yeah here, yeah. Safwan, Jahamun Safwan. It's Safwan, that's Safwan, yeah. No, it's not, you're right, it's without it. It's Jahm ibn Safwan, without an alif al-lam. It's without an alif al-lam. Hiya, inshallah ta'ala, subhanakallahumma bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.